Well, good afternoon. And thank you for joining us this very first day of the academic year when we've just decided to experience summer in September. So thank you all for joining. On behalf of Columbia University and the School of International and Public Affairs, I really am delighted to welcome everyone here for this afternoon's discussion on future trends in energy and geopolitics. As one of the world's great research universities, Columbia is, of course, committed to advancing knowledge and learning. And at the School of International and Public Affairs, where I have the privilege of being dean, we think of ourselves as the interdisciplinary hub of global policy study and engagement at Columbia University. And of course, we are committed not only to advancing knowledge, but also to educating students to serve and to lead by producing new knowledge on critical public policy issues animating the world today. And energy can hardly be overemphasized as one of those critical issue areas at a important crossroads. The Center on Global Energy Policy at CEPA, I think in many ways embodies the pursuit of both of the objectives of knowledge creation and education. And since its inception only 18 months ago, it really has quickly become central to the intellectual life at Columbia and CEPA. Led by its director, Jason Bordoff, the center's policy research, like CEPA's overall, cuts across issues that are homegrown, that are cross-border and international in scope. Energy lies at the nexus of many of the world's most urgent and multifaceted policy challenges, which is why the center's self-defined mission of providing independent, data-driven analysis to help U.S. and global policymakers navigate the complex world of energy is all the more critical and timely. In addition to a robust research agenda and extensive public events such as today's, it is a convener of key policymakers, energy practitioners, and other thought leaders to Columbia, and the center has also attracted a distinguished group of fellows, including the center's newest fellow who will be speaking this afternoon, Ambassador Carlos Pascual, formerly the Special Envoy and Coordinator for International Energy Affairs at the U.S. State Department. Ambassador, we're delighted to have you with us joining our community. The center also provides for our students research assistantships and new initiatives, such as an initiative it launched on women in energy, which is aimed at supporting female Columbia students interested in pursuing careers in the energy sector. CEPA and the center are enriched by being part of a great research university and also by being in this remarkable city, which makes it possible to convene key players from the academy, from the policy community, and also from the business community globally. We believe today's event reflects the unique strengths of Columbia, of CEPA, and of the center, and we hope that this will inspire and foster serious conversations and ideas on global energy policy challenges both of today and the future. It's really a great pleasure for me to now welcome the director of the Energy Center, Jason Bordoff. Thank you for all that you're doing.
Thanks so much, Dean Janow. Thanks to all of you for being here. Thank you, Dean Janow, for joining us here today, and even more importantly, for the extraordinary support and commitment that you, along with President Bollinger and Provost John Coatsworth and everyone else at Columbia, has shown as we've built this new Energy Policy Research Center over the last 18 months. The Center on Global Energy Policy is committed to combining first-rate academic analysis with real-world experience and expertise, and few people combine that in their own experience and in their own lives the way that you do. So I really appreciate you. We're very lucky to have you as our dean. Many of you joined us in this room this past spring to celebrate the center's one-year anniversary and its rapid emergence as a leading venue for public discussion of today's most pressing energy policy challenges. The work it's done to bring rigorous, objective analysis to the energy debate today to ultimately achieve our mission of helping to improve the quality of both energy policy and energy dialogue. And consistent with that rapid growth and success, I'm really thrilled to welcome the newest additions to the center's team. You heard Dean Jaynow welcome Ambassador Pascual already. Also here in the front row is Adrien Lejeune, the former CEO of Pemex and chair of the Oxford Institute for Energy Studies, who is a non-resident fellow with us from Mexico City in the fall, but as of today is here full-time in residence at Columbia and will be doing work for us on Mexican energy reform. And also Keith Benish, who joined us today from the State Department, where he had done work on energy infrastructure issues and on climate diplomacy issues. In the months to come, you'll see exciting new additions to our team, world-class public events, and new research papers emerging from the center on such timely energy policy issues as U.S. energy export policy, the potential for shale in China, the geopolitical implications of a U.S. Energy renaissance, and work around the Paris climate negotiations, among many, many other topics. Today, we're going to discuss many of those geopolitical energy issues and hotspots, and few people are better positioned to speak to that than our keynote speaker today, the CEO of Royal Dutch Shell, Ben van Beurden. We're honored to have him here for what he told me a few minutes ago was his first public speech since he became the CEO of Shell on January 1st, more than three decades after he first joined Shell. Ben's career in Shell spans both upstream and downstream activities in a number of operational and commercial roles. Prior to his selection as the new CEO, he led its refining and marketing business with regional responsibility for Europe and Turkey. He's widely credited with turning around Shell's chemical division after leading its LNG business. He's been a member of the executive committee since January 2013. He takes the helm at a time of really great opportunity and great challenge for the energy industry, with rapidly rising costs, harder and harder to develop resource plays, increasing concerns over climate change and the environmental impacts of production, and geopolitical risk, as we're reminded every day opening the newspaper in many, many places around the world. And Ben's been rather blunt since taking office in directly addressing some of the internal challenges that he believes Shell needs to overcome to succeed in that kind of challenging environment. So we're honored to have him here today at Columbia. After his keynote remarks, he will be joined on stage by Dan Yergin for a conversation. Dan needs no introduction, so his will be brief. He's widely recognized as perhaps the world's leading energy expert. He quite literally wrote the book on the history of oil with the prize for which he won the Pulitzer Prize, which I think he received, was it in this very room, where he received the Pulitzer Prize for that work. Recently did it again with The Quest, telling one of the most insightful and compelling stories about how the energy world is changing today, and really has been a great friend to the Energy Center, serving on our advisory board, participating in many of our events, and devoting a great deal of his scarce time to helping us succeed. He's been a mentor of mine for many years, and so I'm really grateful to Dan for being here again today. You'll notice index cards on your chairs if you have questions for our speakers during the conversation with Ben or our panel that will follow. Please write them on your card and pass them to the aisle, and we'll give those to the moderators to pose. Please also silence your cell phones at this time. After Ben and Dan have a conversation, I'll return again to the stage to moderate a discussion on geopolitical trends in the energy world with a really stellar panel. Ambassador Pascual, our newest fellow, Mona Sutphen, the former White House Deputy Chief of Staff for Policy, and Jean-Francois Poupeau, the Executive Vice President of Schlumberger. And with those logistics out of the way, let's turn to our keynote speaker. Please join me in welcoming to Columbia University the CEO of Royal Dutch Shell, Ben van Beurden.
Well, thank you very much for that warm welcome. It's really a privilege to be here, of course, this afternoon in this wonderful venue. And it's a privilege to address those of you associated with the Center on Global Energy Policy. And even in the short life of the Center, it has made already a very important contribution to energy research, as well as being a hub for the much needed discussion and debate on energy. And I want to congratulate Jason and his colleagues for their endeavors there. I also want to thank Dan Yergin for the work he has done explaining where our energy system has come from, where it's going to. Dan, I very much look forward to our conversation as well. And finally, I would like to thank those of you who are here simply because you're interested in the future of energy, because energy is a fundamental part of our civilization. It powers, it shapes, it sustains our lives, the way we work, the way we travel, the way we communicate. And that's why we need as many people as possible to engage in the critical debate over how we produce and use energy. And to me, the fact that so many of you are here today proves that that debate is urgent and alive just as it needs to be. So today I want to contribute a bit to that debate by asking and then also attempting to answer two questions. Firstly, how do we build a sustainable energy future? And what can a company, an energy company like Shell, do to contribute to that future? And over the next 25 minutes or so, I'll do a number of things. Firstly, I will briefly describe some of the key forces that I see shaping the global energy system at the moment. Secondly, I'll outline a few of the ways I believe policymakers could act to build a sustainable energy system, one that limits the potential threats of climate change. And then finally, I'll describe how we at Shell are contributing to a lower carbon, higher energy future that the world needs and explore some of the steps we need to take together to make it possible. So then, what are some of the factors changing and shaping that future? Now, for one thing, global energy demand is rising and will continue to rise. There are already more than twice as many people on the planet as when I was born 56 years ago. The world population is expected to grow to roughly 7 billion today to 9 billion by the middle of the century, by which time an increasing number of us, actually 3 in 4, will be living in cities. And as the number of people grow, so will their desire for electricity, a TV set, a fridge, a chance to travel. And that's particularly the case in emerging economies like India and China. Now, the International Energy Agency, or IEA, believes that demand for energy could double by 2050 from its baseline just a few years ago. And the IEA also says that meeting that demand will require an average annual spend of more than $2 trillion between now and 2035. So that's investment in the extraction, the transport, refining of oil and gas, power generation, energy efficiency, etc. So that means investing roughly 3 times the entire US military annual budget, 120 times the annual NASA budget, every year for the next 20 years. So meeting energy demand is a massive challenge. But so too is the need to tackle the real and growing threat that climate change poses. Because as things stand, according to both the IEA and the UN Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, we will have to work very hard to limit warming to 2 degrees centigrade, that is. Sorry for thinking in European terms here. Rising demand for energy and concerns over climate change are clearly two of the most powerful influences shaping our energy system today. But what are some of the other factors at work? So, new oil and gas from shale rock have important implications, of course, and not just for North America, but for the global energy system as a whole. Oil production here in the Bakken oil field in North Dakota, for example, recently reached 1 billion barrels a day. And the opening up of new resources, not just here, but in places like Latin America, in the Arctic, will influence where and how energy is traded and transported for decades to come. And of course, geopolitics will also play a crucial part, as ever, with the potential to impact supply and witness what's going on in many places today, like the Ukraine, Iraq, and the South China Sea. and we'll see the continuing influence of new technologies on the way we access and produce energy. The efficiency of oil and gas production will continue to improve, as it has, and renewables like wind and solar and hydrogen and bioenergy will continue to increase their share of the energy mix as they become more advanced and more cost-effective. A rising demand for cleaner, more affordable energy, the shale revolution, more renewable energy, geopolitical strife, and of course climate change, just a few of the forces shaping our energy system. But what's the collective long-term impact of all of those different forces on the way we produce and consume energy? Well, Shell Scenarios team last year published a report mapping out two hypothetical energy futures called mountains and oceans. Now, they're not predictions, but they are plausible scenarios based on very detailed modeling and enormous use in decision-making that we do within the company. So one scenario, the mountain scenario, imagines that power remains concentrated in the hands of economic and political decision-makers. Top-down policy-making will result in more progress on renewables, on hydrogen, and it will also lead to the steady replacement of coal by cleaner burning natural gas. Gas actually will become the backbone of the energy system by the 2030s. There's also quite a quick progress on carbon capture and storage, the technology that can capture carbon emissions at power stations and other plants and store them safely deep underground. Now, in the world of oceans, by contrast, power becomes increasingly devolved away from governments and policymakers. And this spurs innovation and economic growth, which is good, but it also slows consensus building in other areas. And we see slower development of natural gas infrastructures, a greater and more sustained role of coal. And we also see a late shift, maybe as a bit of an overreaction, to energy-efficient infrastructures and CCS, and a very late reduction in greenhouse gas emissions. Now, I won't go into further details on the two scenarios, but for today's purposes, two key observations emerge from both the mountains and the ocean scenarios. First is that governments alone are unlikely to be able to manage a shift to a sustainable energy system. That essential task will require close cross-sector collaboration between governments, business, and civil society. And collaboration will be essential both to get the job done and to ensure that collective action is comprehensive and balanced. And the second observation is equally simple. Despite the significant advances on emissions imagined in the mountains and the ocean scenarios, and in line with IEA and IPCC predictions, unless there is a major shift in how we produce and consume energy, there is only a very small chance of the world limiting warming associated with climate change to 2 degrees Celsius. Now, both observations pose very significant challenges. So what can we do? Now, Shell has made for a long time already the case for natural gas as a versatile, abundant, cleaner burning fuel. And when burned to generate power, it produces half the CO2 that coal does. And the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency, for example, is right to recognize gas as a key means of complying with their emission reduction targets. According to EPA figures, a partial shift from coal to natural gas between 2005 and 2012 helped reduce the U.S. power sector greenhouse gas emissions by 15% already. Now, at Shell, we also believe that natural gas has a long-term role as a flexible backup to intermittent energy sources like solar and wind. A gas-fired plant can start up or stand down much more quickly than a coal-fired plant. And CCS fitted to power plants, meanwhile, could be a real game changer, removing up to 90% of carbon dioxide emissions for power generation. Strong and stable carbon pricing is another essential step. And that's a view Shell shares with the US federal government, the World Bank, and the OECD, amongst others. And indeed, we are pleased to support the World Bank's forthcoming statement on carbon pricing, to be launched at this month's UN Secretary General's Climate Summit here in New York. Because a well-implemented carbon pricing system would help to promote low-carbon technologies, including CCS. It would encourage greater energy efficiency and accelerate the shift to cleaner fossil fuels like natural gas. And it has the added benefit of being relatively cheap to implement and of spreading the burden fairly. Here in the US, there are encouraging signs. Cap and trade mechanisms like the California Emissions Trading System and the 9-state Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative are already empowering the market in the drive to reduce carbon. But there's a place for other forms of regulation too. So the ambitious goals of initiatives like the EPA's Clean Power Plan, which aims to cut power plant-related emissions by 30%, could make a real difference. They give states real clear targets while allowing them the freedom to work with industry, consumers and others on how best to achieve those targets. Now, I've already mentioned the rapid growth of oil production in places like North Dakota. The US is now also the largest producer of natural gas. At Canada and North America now accounts for 25% of the global natural gas production. And that, as you all know, has powerful and very positive implications both for the US economy and for American energy security. And it's also a persuasive argument in favor of the free export of American energy. In fact, I believe that policymakers here in the US should embrace a truly liberalized, diverse, and global energy market. US oil and gas exports would reinforce the long-term future of North American energy production. That would significantly improve the US balance of trade and help to make the global energy system much more stable. But governments cannot be expected to build our energy future on their own. Industry and civil society have vital roles to play as well. And at Shell, we will continue to play our part. We'll continue producing and distributing cleaner, lower carbon natural gas, of course. That's our business. It now accounts for around half of the energy we produce, and 3% of the total global natural gas production. We're one of the world's biggest suppliers of liquefied natural gas. We, of course, always and also continue to improve our energy efficiency of our own operations. All of our major facilities have detailed energy management plans with long-term targets in place. We will continue our pioneering work on major CCS projects. Take, for instance, the Peterhead Power Station in Scotland, which is expected to be the world's first gas-fired plant fitted with CCS. And next year, Shell's Quest CCS project in Alberta will start capturing and storing more than 30% of the CO2 emissions produced when oil sands bitumen is processed into synthetic crude oil. And the project is expected to store more than 1 million tons of CO2 a year, the equivalent of taking 175,000 cars off the road. But importantly, Shell is committed to free sharing of intellectual property and data derived from the Quest CCS project as well. We will continue to develop cleaner, more advanced biofuels, and we continue to look at the potential of onshore wind and hydrogen. Raízen, our biofuels joint venture with Cosan in Brazil, already produces around 2 billion liters a year of low-carbon biofuels from sugarcane, and it's also developing advanced biofuels from leaves and barks and other sugarcane waste. And we will manage this as part of our global portfolio. Shell is opportunity-rich and capital-constrained, which means that we are enhancing our capital efficiency, focusing on better financial performance, and continued strong project delivery, and of course delivering value for shareholders. And we're doing this all from a position of long-term financial health, despite the talk of stranded assets and the so-called carbon bubble. This is an idea that long-term, multi-billion dollar investments in oil and gas will become redundant or stranded if or when governments act more aggressively to regulate emissions. Now, Shell knows that climate change will quite rightly continue to rise up the political and public agenda, we're prepared for increasingly robust legislation on those emissions. We understand that renewables have a huge role to play in the energy system of the future. But in our opinion, the stranded assets thesis underestimates the significance of rising energy demand. It underplays the role natural gas will perform in the global energy system, especially in replacing coal power plants, and it ignores the potential of innovations like CCS. And as you might expect from a company like Shell, our investments take into account potential threats to the viability and profitability of any particular project. And that's why we voluntarily impose a project screening value of $40 per ton of carbon dioxide emitted, ensuring that new projects are viable, even if those projects have to pay a price in future for CO2 emissions. But let me turn now to the crucial role of energy in powering progress. The potentially devastating impact of climate change, if unchecked, is a concern for all of us. But is there a danger of allowing that concern to obliterate the energy story? Have you forgotten the extraordinary benefits we derive from access to energy, the role that energy plays in the lifeblood of human existence? When it comes to discussing energy and climate change, there's a temptation for companies like Shell to play it safe, to avoid the risk of a backlash. But that doesn't serve anyone's interest. I believe that global companies like Shell have a responsibility to society to speak up, to inject pragmatism into a discussion that is too often shaped by misinformation and conjecture, frankly speaking. And because it sometimes feels like energy itself has become a dirty word, that we have forgotten the extraordinary benefits so many of us have enjoyed because of unprecedented access to energy. It's too easy, it seems, to forget the essential contribution energy makes to enterprise, to communication, to quality of life. Energy powers economies, and without it, the lights go out. Without energy, our lives would be almost unrecognizable. Yet, worldwide, 3 billion people still lack access to modern energy, the modern energy that many of us here take for granted. According to the World Bank, more than 500 million people in Africa have no access to energy, to electricity. 10 million small and medium-sized enterprises in Africa are struggling to grow because of lack of power. The entire African continent, with a population of more than 1 billion people, has a total power generating capacity of about 80,000 megawatts. That's roughly the same as the combined capacity of New York State and Pennsylvania. Access to energy isn't just about whether a household can have a television or an air conditioning. In Africa, as in as much of the world outside Africa, access to energy is a difference between prosperity and poverty, sometimes between sickness and death. And I'm concerned that the terms of the debate around climate change have become so entrenched that the assumptions of that debate are too simplistic and sometimes flawed. There has been a tendency, for instance, to assume that the twin strategy of renewables and energy efficiency will simply be enough to meet the growing demand for energy. Now, the US Energy Administration estimates that 11% of today's global energy comes from renewables, like hydropower, biofuels, wind, geothermal, and solar. But it also estimates that even by 2040, that number will have increased to only 15%. Now, Shell Scenarios team, for its part, believes the figure could be as high as 25%, actually, by 2050. But it still leaves 75% of energy demand needing to be met by traditional sources like oil, gas, and nuclear. And that's an energy system that is twice as big as what we have today. Optimism is welcome. We need optimism. But we also need to temper our expectation of a zero-carbon future with the understanding that there are significant technological and economical obstacles. We urgently need to broaden the frame of discussion. The reality is that historically, new energy sources have taken around 30 years to establish even a 1% share of the market. The scale and the cost of the energy infrastructure are simply too large to expect anything else. Today, wind and solar combined provide less than 1% of global primary energy. It took 30 years to get there. If they're to grow, if they're to deliver hundreds of millions from poverty, the world's economies can't wait. The simple truth is, for an energy system to be truly sustainable, it doesn't need just to be lower carbon, it simply needs to be higher energy. Building that system is going to involve a lot of effort by a lot of people. The UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon recently observed, in our increasing interconnected world, vision and ambition must be advanced by a diverse and dynamic public-private partnership. Together, we can leverage our strength, multiply our means, and shift the global climate trajectory. Ban Ki-moon's words. Now, I want to add my voice to that of Secretary General Ban. I would like to find ways for Shell to play a greater role in closer coalition of governments, business, and civil society, one defined by better mutual understanding and by dialogue. As to exactly how it might work, it's very early days yet. I know there's a lot of work to do to make it happen. But here's a glimpse of what such a coalition approach might look like. And you may be surprised to hear that it's not informed by things happening here or in Europe. In recent years, Shell has worked closely with the Chinese government's Development Research Center, the DRC, to help map out a sustainable energy future for China. A two-year joint study identified the key challenges facing the country and proposed very, very detailed, pragmatic solutions. Support for innovation, electricity and gas reforms, the liberalization of energy prices, carbon trading, cleaner mobility, and more resource-efficient urban development, all things that have since been set in motion. A new joint study is examining China's gas development strategy. We just kicked it off a few months ago, including looking at supply-side measures to accelerate domestic production and demand to promote the use of gas in China. Now, what are some of the benefits of those two collaborative projects? A greater role for clean burning natural gas, more resource efficient urban planning, improved energy efficiency, etc. Now, China is, of course, a special case. But it is, if this sort of cross-sector collaboration became the norm and not the exception, wouldn't our collective energy future look a whole lot brighter? Now, my company has a long track record of working in partnership with others. We have numerous energy-related joint ventures and partnerships all over the world, with governments, national oil and gas companies, and many other firms. And we have close ties with universities like MIT and Tsinghua in Beijing, and we have collaborative partnerships with a range of leading environmental, non-governmental organizations. And whenever we plan a new major project or extend an existing one, we work closely with NGOs to reduce the environmental impact. And we also work very closely with local communities to enable them to share in the benefit of our activities in terms of creating jobs and developing skills that will boost local economies. In other words, we do understand the value of building long-lasting cross-sector partnerships. And we, along with others, have much to learn if we are to collaborate on an unprecedented scale required. But I believe there is a constructive and a credible role that my company can play in this space. And as the CEO, I have been determined to lead that effort. So in conclusion then, the world, as we all know, is experiencing an energy transition, a multi-decade energy transition. That transition is being driven by a range of factors, including demand for cleaner energy, new resources, shifting geopolitics, and technological innovation. But two major challenges dominate: the urgent need to meet the rising demand for global energy and the urgent need to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. Those two needs are going to be very difficult to satisfy at the same time. As things stand, we won't succeed. There are pressing things I believe the world needs to do. It must embrace cleaner burning natural gas. Governments should support the development of innovations like CCS. They must implement carbon pricing as a flexible and pragmatic solution to rising emissions and the need to encourage diversity of global supply. But I also believe a reboot is needed for what has become a skewed global debate around energy future, a debate which too often neglects the vital benefits so many derive from access to energy. And we must explore and develop a new model of cross-sector collaboration. In his most recent State of the Union speech, President Obama, of course a Columbia alumnus, said, "When our children's children look us in the eye and ask if we did all we could to leave them a safer, more stable world with new energy sources, I want us to be able to say, yes, we did." Well, I and everyone I work with at Shell want to be able to say that too. None of us is under the illusion that what we need to do will be easy, though. But I'm proud to be the CEO of a company that is prepared to try. I'm proud to say that Shell will continue to seek out and apply innovative, pragmatic, long-term solutions in building the safer, more stable, energy-rich future that the world needs. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ben, for that very wide-ranging, insightful, pragmatic speech. And it's very notable that you chose SEPA and the center as the place to give your first major speech and to reboot the conversation. There are cards that people will collect in the audience for questions, but I thought we might start with a couple of questions actually about carbon. You talked about a $40 a ton internal hurdle rate within Shell. Can you say a little more about what that means, how that works, and why $40?
The $40 we actually have already for quite a few years. We started talking about climate change, what we should do about it, probably in the late 90s already. The screening price for carbon came around that time as well. A lot of debate on what we thought would be a global price, should a carbon price emerge, and we, after a lot of studies, settled on $40 as a sort of a good median number. The way we apply it, basically in every investment proposal, we basically disadvantage the economics of the project with a $40 per ton price on CO2. And basically I look at the economics, how it would look like with $40 a ton CO2 price, whether that CO2 price actually is applicable to that project, yes or no. In that way, we basically want to understand whether the project is robust against such outcome.
So do some of the projects actually fall out when you use that criteria?
Yeah, and of course, when we have special projects, so these are projects that fall what we would sort of consider to be the top 20% of our CO2 emission project, we actually do a bit of a special study on it. We just say, well, maybe the sort of simple approach of let's take $40 a ton is not applicable. Let's do a more in-depth study and understand how CO2 pricing in this particular economy could develop, and then we do a special case on it. It's only one of the ways to ensure that projects are robust for future CO2 regulation. We also look at energy intensity of our portfolio as a whole.
Right. You mentioned the carbon bubble, stranded carbon. So when you meet with institutional investors and they raise this issue, if they do raise it, what do you say to them?
Well, a lot of investors are of course interested in it because their clients ask, what do we do with this? We get a lot of pressure or advice or suggestion that we should divest ourselves from energy companies because their assets will become stranded. So what's your view on it? And of course, the thinking on it is relatively sort of immature in the investment world. So they basically come to us and say, help us explain to our clients. And the story that I tell is, of course, one that, first of all, explains how we make our portfolio more robust against climate change, a CO2 emission regulation, how energy demand is bound to rise, how, therefore, I think assets will not become stranded, certainly not in the time frames that people talk about. But I also talk about how I believe that this is fundamentally a red herring discussion. We will have rising CO2 amounts whether or not people invest in actually relatively small players of the global energy system, and therefore the discussion needs to be, what are we going to do with CO2 emissions? Not, can we somehow punish IOCs for it? And I think that's probably an area where investors are not so much interested, but I think it's the discussion that we need to have.
Thank you. You talked about U.S. being an oil and natural gas exporter, and of course, 5 years ago, that would have seemed something that couldn't possibly be on the agenda. And if I heard you correctly, the view of Shell is that we should have open markets and not restrictions on exports.
Yeah, I think that is a bit of a fundamental point as well that underpins that. I think we believe in free trade. If you are an enterprise like ours, you have to believe in free trade. I'm very aware of all the complexities and sensitivities that will surround the issue, but I believe also that it is in the interest of the country, consumers in this country in the end, to do have free trade, to be able to export oil and gas freely, to import perhaps an oil and gas mix that is, or an oil mix rather, that is more suited for the refining industry that we have here. In a way, probably, it is going to be a bigger contribution, not only to energy security, but also to stability of energy prices, than somehow having a ban on exports, which, you have to remember, came about in a completely different environment than the environment we are facing at the moment. So I think some of the discussion that is taking place is incomplete. Maybe that's a polite way of saying is that it's somewhat misinformed. I actually believe that the whole discussion of exports somehow having an effect on pump prices is actually, well, as any sort of novice observer already of the system can quickly eliminate, is actually a fallacy. Prices at the pump are being determined by all product markets, which are global markets, for which the U.S. has not insulated itself. So therefore, you could argue that it has nothing to do with that argument. I understand the complexities and the sensitivities. I don't think it would be sensible to argue for an immediate opening overnight, but a systematic and gradual opening up of the export ban, I think, would be a sensible thing to do.
Right. Well, to follow up on that, Shell probably has a better understanding of the global natural gas business, or as good an understanding as any company. The U.S. will be exporting natural gas probably within a little over a year. What impact do you see the U.S. having on the global gas market? What impact on geopolitics? Help us look ahead 5 years from now.
I think in 5 years, not an awful lot will happen, Dan. These are very, very complex projects that will take a long term to develop. Quite often in Europe, we now hear politicians say, well, with all the security issues that we may have due to the Russian crisis, we should quickly ask the U.S. to export a little bit more gas to us. Well, that's a naive way of looking at things. This will take at least 5, if not 10 years, to really make any significant impact. So, but if you then look at what is happening here, yes, tremendous amount of resource to work with, huge amount of projects. I believe it's about 300 million tons of LNG export projects being announced in 30 projects altogether. But there's only two that have been sanctioned, by the way, which is already indicative of how difficult and how hard it is to pull these things off. Now, at the same time, the world will need a significant increase in supply of liquefied natural gas. At the moment, we have about 230 million tons in the global market. Let's say in 10, 15 years' time, that could double. So therefore, there is room for, and actually need for, supplies from North America. And I think something like 50, 70 million tons by 2025 could be sort of a reasonable expectation. That will certainly help. It will alleviate global supply pressures. Will it make a massive difference for gas pricing in the U.S.? I don't believe so. I think the gas market supply is going to be so deep in this continent that a 70 million ton export does not put a major dent in it.
Right. Well, let's go upstream then from LNG exports and back to shale gas. There are several questions, and let me organize them into kind of three parts about shale gas. One is Shell has been divesting shale gas resource in the U.S. What has Shell learned about shale gas over the last 5 or 6 years? How thinking has changed within Shell? Secondly, is this a global revolution or is this a North American revolution? And thirdly, there are a couple of questions that particularly want to know about your experience with shale gas in China. So a long three-part question.
You may have to remind me of some components of it. I think it's going to be predominantly a North American phenomenon for some time to come. Certainly on the sort of scale that we are experiencing it here, don't expect it anytime soon anywhere else. And believe me, we have tried very, very hard in places like China, Ukraine, other places as well. And of course, you have a much less advanced system, a much less advanced regulatory environment, a much less advanced supply chain. Places like China, you have much less advanced commercial arrangements, market mechanisms. You have much fewer data to work with. So it's going to take a lot longer. If you think of it, although the sort of revolution that we now call it seems to have taken us all by surprise and by storm, it has been a long, long term in the making. So, well, will it take another 40 years before China will become a major Shell player? Probably not, but it's not going to happen in 2 or 3 years' time. And the same will be the case for some other economies around the world. But it doesn't mean that there aren't other places where the geology is very, very promising. Indeed, China is one, Russia is one, Argentina is one, there's some other places, Algeria, etc., where we do see a lot of geological promise. Now, what have we learned in the US? I think we probably have learned, if I'm very frank about it, that you can be too greedy and too hungry when it comes to looking at opportunities. We've rightly concluded that we couldn't leave this very significant resource, which could be, you know, up to a third of the total hydrocarbon resource that is freely accessible for IOCs. We couldn't just leave that to one side and say, that's not for us. So I think the decision to get in there was the right decision. I think the speed with which we have done it, the volume that we have taken on, actually has given us a little bit of indigestion, to be perfectly honest. Because not only did we take on a tremendous amount of acreage, we then with it took on a tremendous amount of commitment to invest in it, follow on investment to bring it into productive use. And I think we have gone through a process now of sort of rationalizing that portfolio a little bit, sort of bringing it back to the most promising bits and pieces, and actually shedding the areas where either the position wasn't material enough or not attractive enough, or where we believe somebody else has a better approach or a better starting point to make money with it. Now, some of the other things we've learned sort of fundamentally is that, yes, it's a different type of game than conventional, but it's not a game that is best left to the independents. It is a game that we can play and win at as well. There's no reason why we can't be cost efficient in the same way as independents are. And we have something else to bring there as well. We have the ability to integrate in the value chain. So I can make a Canadian gas proposition, Shell gas proposition, a whole lot more attractive because I don't have to sell it for $4 a million BTU in the low of 48. I can export it to the North Asian market in the form of LNG. There's other ways in which we can integrate it. So we can add value to it because of our global reach and our technology capabilities. But fundamentally, it will only work irrespective of how good you are in terms of cost, how good you are in terms of value chain integration. It will only work if you sit on the right geology. And I think that is something that the whole industry has learned quite rapidly, actually, and we with it, is the ability to make the decisions to find the sweet spot quickly without wasting too much time and money is going to be crucial to the success if you want to participate in this business.
In other words, all shales are not the same.
And all shales are not the same. Yeah.
Shell has recently announced, and two questions here about that, once again, going back to the Arctic, to the Chukchi Sea. Tell us what Shell's thinking is and how you're approaching it.
Well, I think if you look at the Arctic in general is still a massive resource in terms of the potential that it has.
So you could argue that the world, one way or other, will need to tap into that resource, particularly on the oil side. We have chosen to enter that in Alaska. You could argue we could have taken an easier way to do it. Some of our competitors have taken Russia, but it looks easier for a little while. Probably now looks challenged in another way. But for whatever it's worth, we have a position in Alaska that we try to make worth. We think we can do this responsibly, safely. We think the resource has a very high probability of indeed being there. We think it's not a challenging resource from a geological perspective. But we do know operating in the Arctic is incredibly challenging. And probably many of you who have observed our company will have seen that indeed we have had some operational issues there as well. Nothing to do with drilling, but with logistics of rigs and everything else. So we need to get it right. We paused it because we felt that we had a little bit more work to do to get it right. And then we were ready to do it this year. But then at the 11th hour, we got a challenge, or rather the U.S. government got a challenge on the original lease conditions in the Ninth Circuit Court. And so again, we were being frustrated by that. So at that point in time, I had no other option but to say this was sort of a few weeks into my tenure. Let's just pause it again and resolve all of this, because it's not just a matter of getting it right from a technical, economic, logistical perspective, but also making sure that commercially it makes sense and legally we can do it. So we are working our way to resolve this. In the meantime, we have not demobilized in any significant way, so the meter is ticking still, and therefore we have to understand how we keep all our options open to again have an attempt at it in 2015. Which doesn't mean, by the way, that I have decided to do this, but I want to be able to decide yes if all the conditions line up and we believe it does make sense. And therefore we had to submit a permit to the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management to make sure that indeed we would have everything in place if all the other factors would line up as well. So we have paused it, we haven't abandoned it, we haven't decided to go ahead with it. We will only go ahead if we can convince ourselves, and of course with us, governments and other stakeholders, that it can be done in a responsible way.
You talked about challenging areas, and in your speech you talked about geopolitical challenges, and two of the big ones on your agenda, as with the others in the global energy industry, are of course Russia and Iraq. So maybe first we might talk about Russia, whereas a year ago, much support for Western companies operating in Russia as a way to build an economic foundation to release a relationship. Things have changed dramatically, but the type of investments you've made are 20, 30-year investments. What do you do? And how do you see it?
It's a very good question, Dan. I think, of course, a company like ours, no matter how hard we try to stay away from politics and diplomacy and everything else, simply because we don't have a mandate to play in that space, do get tangled up in political issues, geopolitical issues, simply because of the importance of the commodity that we work with. I think it is inevitable that we are exposed to these sort of risks. We have been exposed to these sort of risks in the 100 plus years that we have existed. And really, the only way you can deal with it is to make sure that you spread your risks and your exposures, that you manage them as best as you can, that you don't overexpose yourself, that you demand the right sort of returns if the risks are higher. And of course, you act as sort of prudent and responsible as possible. You know, I don't have a real solution to a escalating problem between Russia and Europe or the West, where you would have escalating sanctions and a tit-for-tat behavior and nationalization of our assets. If that were to happen, there is no way you can inoculate yourself against it, other than spreading risk. Now, of course, we do have a role to play in making sure that policymakers, politicians understand the things that are at stake. Not just the business interests of us, but also the wider implications on what could sanctions mean for energy security. Is this really something that serves the longer-term interest of markets, of Western countries. I think the jury is out on that, and you could argue that we probably, you know, even if he would succeed in sanctions, there may come a time that we regret having to rebuild all the damage that I have done. So in the end, I believe it is a matter of dialogue, and it's a matter of getting people around the table to resolve this. And yeah, I think the role that we can play in that is actually fairly limited, Dan.
Right. What about Iraq, where you also made a significant commitment, and now a picture that's so dramatically different from the way things looked 6 months ago?
Yeah, it's incredibly worrying. We are exposed in Iraq in the south, in the Basra region. The good news is that that is actually a relatively stable area for reasonably sustainable reasons. Most of the turmoil will take a long time before it starts to affect us in the south. But you can't be complacent in that area. We have hundreds of expatriates there and Iraqi staff on top of it. So we take our security concerns incredibly seriously. But for now, I think we see that we can continue to operate and invest in a reasonable way there if situation doesn't escalate a whole lot further. Also there, Dan, I think it's the same approach. You have to accept that Iraq is going to be, like a few other places in around the world, is going to be a high-risk area. So you limit your exposure and you demand a certain return that is sort of commensurate with the risk that you take.
Right. The two other areas of the world that several people have asked questions about, and I'm afraid we won't be able to get to all of the questions. One is, of course, Shell has long experience in Africa, but do you see Africa becoming, playing an even larger role in the global energy market? And the other is, obvious question, are you paying attention to what's happening in Mexico?
Yes and yes. I think, yeah, Africa will play a very important role. I hope it will play a very important role for some of the reasons that I mentioned. It is a very underdeveloped continent. At the same time, it goes through a very, very fast growth rate, fastest growth rate economically that we have around the globe, from a very small base, but it shows the potential that, that the continent still has. It has good resources as well, of course. Some of it we have been invested in for a long time. Nigeria, Gabon. Nigeria, we are actually sort of restructuring our portfolio to get out of the onshore oil, focus a lot more on gas and on offshore oil for obvious reasons. But also in Eastern Africa, we are very active, trying to indeed play a role in the very rapidly emerging basins that we see there. It is, talking about Eastern Africa, it's going to take some time. Again, Dan, I think it, you know, and I'm sure you will have observed this many times yourself as well, these are very, very complicated projects to pull off, particularly the gas projects. Think of what needs to happen if you find 100 TCF of gas in Mozambique, a country that has no infrastructure when it comes to building projects. And we need to build probably $30, $40, $50 billion worth of infrastructure there in a relatively short period of time. How is that going to happen? And on top of it, we will have to find markets for it. And when I talk about we, I talk about the industry. So this is not going to be an easy or trivial thing to do. It will take years. It will take top-tier players like ourselves and our top-tier IOC peers to pull it off. Not always the people who actually sit on the resource there. So I think it will come, but it will take some time. Mexico, I have very, very high hopes for. I've been involved with Mexico for quite a few years. Been involved in some of the thinking around importing LNG in Mexico. That's a little bit of a potential white elephant at the moment, of course. But I think what has happened in the country, I think, is fantastic. The way the administration has taken the bull by the horn, so to speak, is very, very encouraging. A lot of admiration for the courage that the president takes, that Pemex takes, to open up the industry, to put a lot of political capital in it. And I, for what I see, is that doing the right thing. And I think it will be something that I will come to look back on as something that I should have done earlier.
Well, Ben, we have a whole host of great questions that we can't ask, ranging from the future of the electric car to and its role, what it means for your business, to how countries can manage the volatility of energy investment. But I think the lesson of that is to save those questions for the next time that you come back to this forum. But let me now just express on behalf of SEPA and the center and everybody here, thank you very much for coming and sharing your thinking today.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ben, and thank you, Dan. Dan, you can actually remain on stage after you've bid farewell to our guest of honor. And let me ask at this time if Mona and Carlos and JF could also please join us on stage. Dan has already been introduced and also needs no introduction. Let me quickly introduce our other panelists and then I'll take a seat for our conversation. Mona Sutphen has spent her career focused at the intersection of macroeconomic geopolitical risk and policy issues, presently as a partner at Macro Advisory Partners and previously as a managing director both at UBS and Stonebridge International. She's a member of the President's Intelligence Advisory Board and served as Deputy White House Chief of Staff for Policy from 2009 to 2011. Ambassador Carlos Pascual, you can sit anywhere. I'm honored to say has since today, as of today, is now a fellow at the Center on Global Energy Policy. You heard Dean Janow introduce him before, so I will be brief. He will, until last month, was in the U.S. State Department, where he established and directed the new Bureau of Energy Resources there from 2011 to 2013 to 2014. Previously, was the U.S. Ambassador to both Mexico and the Ukraine. Pretty relevant areas for what's happening in energy geopolitics today, and he will focus his writing and teaching and lecturing while he's at the center on the geopolitical implications of what's happening in the North American energy landscape. And then finally, Jean-Francois Poupeau is executive vice president at Schlumberger, which is the world's largest oil field services company. It's on the front lines of operating in many of today's most geopolitically and technologically challenging environments. He's worked at Schlumberger for nearly 30 years, joining as a field engineer in the Gulf of Mexico, worked in North America, Indonesia, Thailand, Angola, Nigeria, France, and China, so has deep experience and expertise to inform our conversation as we walk around the world of energy geopolitics today. So please join me in thanking and welcoming all of our guests. Dan, let me start with you, if I could. I'm going to start with a couple of one or two broad questions about energy geopolitics, and then I really kind of want to do walk around the world quickly in the 55 minutes we have about a few of the key hotspots today. But as you look at the geopolitical risk we face, if 3 or 4 years ago someone had told you there'd be an Arab Spring, we'd see what we're seeing in Russia and the Ukraine, conflict in Iraq, we'd have a North American energy revolution at the same time, the price of oil would barely move. And if you could talk a little bit about why that is and what you see as the prospects for further disruptions in global supply, or you know, do you feel a bit more complacent about what the geopolitical implications on the energy sector might be of what's happening today in the world?
Well, I never feel complacent. I think that you know one of the kind of rules I've learned is that when everybody pretty much agrees on the consensus in energy and where everything is going to go, that's about the time you should expect some surprises. And look at the Arab Spring and Fukushima, both happened very close to each other, and we've seen so many developments since then, including a war between Russia and Ukraine. So, but it is, you know, the puzzle, why is the oil price kind of shrugged it all off? And it has to do with what we were just talking about, which is, among other things, this incredible rapid growth in U.S. oil supply, which has also been a huge surprise. The increase in U.S. oil production since 2008, just the increase is greater than the output of 11 out of the 12 OPEC countries. And so it's the increase in U.S. oil supplies that has pretty much just balanced out about a 3.5 million barrels a day of disruption. And I do think that if we hadn't seen this revolution, as Ben called it, we would actually be looking at a severe oil crisis, and we would not have had a recovery from the Great Recession.
Carlos, can you come in on that question of the impacts on the oil market, the 3 million barrels a day of disruption of what's happening geopolitically, but then also talk for a minute about gas and how you see the global LNG market transforming over the next several years and what impact largely Russia and the Ukraine, but other areas too, are having on the global gas market.
So I think, first of all, starting off on oil and picking up on Dan's point, what is both stunning on the one hand is, as you say, we're in a global oil market with 3 million barrels of oil a day being disrupted. And we've seen the price of oil over the past year be remarkably steady, with some exceptions when it went up to about $117 a barrel or so when ISIS started to make its march into Iraq, and there was a lot of speculation of what was going to happen on the stability of that market. And what it has showed us is, on the one hand, how remarkable the impact has been of U.S. production coming into this market. What it also forces us to think about is, if you did not have the political instability that, or let's say the political risk that might be priced in because of the Middle East, because of Iran, where might we actually see oil prices right now? And it suggests to us that we have this market where we've got to be pricing in that degree of political risk. And so it suggests to us that there is a fair degree of flexibility that we must be able to see in that market, given that circumstance. And part of that has been what we have seen on the demand side of the equation, which has just been the compression of demand, particularly because of global recession and the compression of demand in Europe. And so the thing that keeps me at the point of as Dan says, not being complacent, is this question of what could happen next. And if we still come back to that question, there really is one country that still has the dominant spare capacity in the global market, and it's Saudi Arabia. And so, you know, if you ask the question, what happens if, let's say, picking on Ben van Beurden's point about stability in southern Iraq, but if it wasn't that, but if you had a terrorist attack in the southern parts of the country, what happens to pick up another 1.5 million barrels a day in disruption? And you basically have one country to essentially pick up that quick increase in supply because of spare capacity. And that's one of the things that we have to keep on remembering in terms of the importance of Saudi Arabia in particular and the Middle East. On the issue of gas, one of the things that has truly struck me is the quickly evolving nature of gas markets globally and the degree of competition that we're starting to see in those markets. In fora here that we've had in the past, we've talked about the European market. And yes, Russia is a dominant supplier into that market. Yes, it is a key geopolitical and security issue. But there's a degree of optionality that Europe has today because of the onset of LNG, because of supplies out of Norway, out of Algeria, that have created options and possibilities for competition with Russian gas, which are not going to displace that gas, but put a competitive environment around that, which is radically different from what we had in the disruptions that we saw in 2008 and 2009. If we look at the Asian market right now, as Ben was talking, I was thinking about, you know, where's the JKM market today, and it's at about $10 per million BTU. And so for a market which has been highly dependent and linked to the price of oil, where the price of oil has been totally steady, we've seen the price of gas in Asia come down from $18 per million BTU to down to about 10. Which tells us that there are competitive changes that are happening in the global gas market that are critical factors for the ability to utilize and adopt gas that are beginning to influence the nature of contracts in those markets, and eventually are going to have an impact on producer-supplier relationships that we're starting to see throughout the world. And these are some of the things that we still haven't completely and fully absorbed into the geopolitical implications and the market implications of those products. If we had said 2 years ago that we would say, I don't think we generally would have believed that there would be a $10 per million BTU price of gas in Asia at this point in time. And certainly Australia would have been panicked about it because of the high price of production. So these are all developments that we're starting to see that is the one thing that, Ben, I would just slightly counter to the point that you made, that these changes that we're going to see in gas markets are going to be slow. And the thing that keeps surprising me is that you're starting to see changes in pricing and contracts that are moving even faster than what we would have assumed or predicted 5 years ago. And so we need to stay on top of that and understand what those dynamics are to the geopolitical relationships about among some of the key countries.
And so just to be clear on what's happened to gas prices in Asia, you see that driven not just by demand and economic weakness and seasonal factors, but by pressure and renegotiation of contracts and the kind of competition we saw in Europe over the last couple of years starting to make its way to Asia.
It's beginning, it's limited, it's shallow, the infrastructure is still not deep, but it shows you how, let's say, small changes like Papua New Guinea coming online much more quickly than was ever expected, how that can begin to have an impact in that market. And the importance of those impacts in pricing changes in places, say, like China, that give it some greater possibility of how at least the coastal areas of China can be able to begin to look at gas for switching out of coal in the industrial sector and moving more into gas as a cleaner alternative fuel.
So in your remarks, you sort of asked the question of, you know, what might come next, what geopolitical areas one might be concerned about. So Moni, you spent a lot of time thinking about that question. As you look at the areas that have the biggest impact on energy markets, where do you see as sort of risks in either direction?
Yeah, it's funny you have this question, because I actually, it should be the opposite. Which hot spots aren't on people's radar screen already? Because I think most of them are actually pretty visible to market players at this point, right? You're worried, obviously, about all the headline risks that we know about. Obviously, what's going on in the East and South China Sea, which I think is an early stage story we're going to be living with for a long time. The continued rise of Islamists in sub-Saharan Africa, which I think are going to lay bare some of the structural infrastructure weaknesses from a security standpoint for a whole host of governments, which we saw, unfortunately, with Nigeria earlier this year. So I can't say that I have any surprises. I will say that I've always had two, when people ask me, what's the biggest geopolitical risk out there that you're worried about from a national security perspective? And it's actually been the same answer for 15 years. One is Pakistan and one is North Korea, mainly because of obviously very unstable politically and nuclear armed states, right? And so the consequences of a wind down in either of those are actually beyond our ability really to imagine. But I will add one that is directly energy related, which is this independence referendum in Scotland in 3 weeks, which we've been watching for 7 months. And I think now finally starting to spill over into the public realm a little bit more. I've been wondering when it might be able to get enough bump behind it to break through the rest of the noise. And I think could, in the end, I think it's a question, you know, it's a 50-50 shot how it goes, but it's a lot closer and pretty significant, I think, implications for actually the structuring of businesses that have interests and operations in Scotland and what it means, obviously, for the pound and North Sea oil.
Yeah, and potential implications for North Sea.
Can I ask you then, since you brought that up, and I think, as you say, most people haven't, at least on this side of the Atlantic, haven't really thought about it. What happens?
Right. Well, this is part of the problem is I don't think people are actually really talking that much about what happens the next day. There's, in theory, this idea that somehow there would be a negotiation on basic things, like are they going to adopt the pound, could they join the EU, and that somehow that's going to happen in suspended animation while the markets just pretend as though this massive, that Great Britain is maybe no longer great, right? And I don't think there's been a lot of thinking about it in the actual nuts and bolts of what does it actually mean from a legal perspective and otherwise. And obviously, if you're sitting at number 10, you don't really want to have that conversation because you don't want to fuel that consideration. So I think it's got a lot of room for surprise. Most people, the conventional wisdom is still that the undecideds are going to swing in the no direction. But if you look at the polling that's just come out over the last couple of weeks, and we've done our own polling, it's that margin is shrinking pretty significantly.
Do you want to make a prediction on?
No, I've learned a long time ago. I've been in U.S. politics way too long. Never make a prediction on any election outcome.
JF, your company operates in all these areas. How are the service companies responding to these geopolitical risks?
Yeah, well, the Arab Spring, has been a little while behind us, and we've been operating for many years, even before that, in regions, that are slightly unstable. We have an extensive back office support in terms of security infrastructure. Consulting, and we keep a very, very close eye on the goings-on and the environments where we are. So, for example, in northern Iraq, we evacuated all of our personnel when our customers did so, and we're ready to go back in whenever they do come back in. And in general, you would never hear about Schlumberger's, whereabouts or positioning in all these topics because we have nothing to gain. We're just there to provide services for our customers, and we just stay right behind the scenes. But we're always there to provide services, whether it's in Yemen, everywhere, actually. So we're very careful. We take the utmost care in the security of our personnel. That's number one. And then we're always ready to help out when our customers go back to work.
I was curious if you had responses or thoughts to what Ben said about the potential for shale outside North America, given that Schlumberger is on the front lines of trying to figure out whether people can make that work.
Yeah, so actually we're quite lucky in that Shell is one of our top customers, and we've been working very closely with them in the shale days, if you will, whether it's in the Sichuan Basin in China or in South Texas. So we have our thesis is that. We believe the selective application of technology at certain phases in the process, i.e. early on to identify the sweet spots that Ben pointed out, may not necessarily happen, as we would wish. We believe that's one of the solutions. And we have a constant focus on developing technologies that allow the more efficient, both commercially and viably, methods to get hydrocarbons out of the ground. In North America, our license to operate, I don't think can go on forever the way it is, all the trucking, the emissions, et cetera. So we work very closely with our customers in developing these technologies. And again, our focus, whether it's ourselves or our customers, are always to help reduce the extraction costs, of the system, right? To be able to bring them to the market always in a more commercially viable means.
Carlos, can we turn to Russia and Ukraine, which is top of mind and news for a lot of people today. Can you talk a little bit about the risks to European and Ukrainian supply going into winter, the kind of steps you see people taking or what they should be taking, both in the near term and the medium term, and then generally how you view Western sanctions potentially escalating, what they might mean for energy markets?
First of all, the situation that has evolved between Russia and Ukraine is, I think, one of the most difficult, serious, and urgent international policy challenges that we face today. It is the first time we've seen a country invade the sovereign territory of another sovereign state in Europe. It happened with Crimea. There were a series of interventions on the part of Russia and promoting insurgency in eastern Ukraine. In recent days, increased evidence of Russian troops participating on Ukrainian territory. And it's that context, it's in that context that these energy issues have to be resolved. It's not just simply a question of trying to get parties to become reasonable to one another on energy policy. It is emerged as something which is fundamentally has to address a war which is taking place within the sovereign territory of Ukraine and how to deal with it. And it's in that context that the international community said that a military response by the international community is not viable and reasonable. There has to be another solution. And so if you start from that perspective, it begins to frame all of the options that can be addressed or used to try to resolve the broader military conflict and how the energy issues within it actually then play themselves out. If you look at this from a European perspective, Europe imports 165, 170 billion cubic meters of gas a year from Russia out of a total consumption of plus or minus 500 or so. And about half of that goes through Ukraine. It's a significant amount. There are some alternatives on how much can be moved through the Nord Stream and Yamal pipelines. But if overall, if one starts to look at this balance between Europe and Russia and the demand-supply relationships, a couple of things become clear. One is that Russia is also dependent on Europe as a market. Russia has built 220 billion cubic meters worth of pipeline capacity to Europe. The largest alternative right now is 14 billion cubic meters in LNG exports out of Sakhalin. It signed, as we've all seen, a contract that will eventually build up to 38 billion cubic meters of export into China. But today, Europe is Russia's gas market. And it's not the principal determinant of hydrocarbon resources or revenue in Russia, as Ben said. Oil by far is. But if you look at gas and the viability and success of the gas market for Russia, it is impossible to define that within in the near term without the viability of exporting into Europe. Okay? The reason that that is so key is that both sides need to understand this mutual dependency and why the two can benefit of having an outcome that allows for the continued smooth and uninterrupted supply of gas into Europe. So then bring Ukraine into the equation. Ukraine is not receiving natural gas from Russia today, and resolving that situation has become extraordinarily complicated. From Gazprom's perspective, their point of view is Ukraine pays, we can have a contract negotiation. From Ukraine's perspective is that we've had a country which has invaded our country, is conducting war, and how can we have a normal commercial relationship around these issues? The two sides almost came to agreement in June, and it fell apart at the last minute. Interestingly, not because of price, not because I think of debt issues, but because of contract structures. Because the Ukrainians insisted that Gazprom would have to put in place a contract that was based on mutually binding conditions, not one in which Gazprom was offering discounts on a previously negotiated price. Because from the Ukrainian perspective, the previous discount that was offered was on the Black Sea Fleet in Crimea, and suddenly Russia said, well, you can't get that discount any longer because we just took your territory. So it became politically impossible for Ukraine to simply accept the previous pricing structures. The reason Russia couldn't accept that is that all of its contracts in Central Europe are structured that way. They're based on a negotiated price that might be around 420, 440 billion cubic meters, dollars per thousand cubic meters. And so the implication would have been that Russia would have had to go back and change those contracts over time. That is the conundrum that we find these actors in. And one of the things that I think is going to be critical, Jason, to resolve this situation is to bring Ukraine into a wider European market situation. If it becomes just a simple issue of Russia and Ukraine and the two of those trying to work out a solution, it is still going to be terribly sensitive politically. If you can bring Ukraine into the context of being, as it is now, part of the European energy community, And if Europe can insist that because of that, Ukraine has to be treated according to the same market rules of Europe, that can begin to become the foundation for a solution that is a win-win situation for Ukraine and Europe in getting the gas, for Russia of sustaining the relationship with the European market, and that potentially can be part of an overall solution to the conflict. But unfortunately, it's hard to see how that's going to happen right now if there isn't a broader solution to the security conflict on the ground. For both sides, it has just become too big, too painful, and too intense.
Dan, on the Russia question, do you have thoughts on how sanctions are playing out right now and what impact you see it having on Western companies and their ability to operate in Russia?
Well, I think for the Western companies, it's a conundrum because many of them was encouraged to do business in Russia. As the economic political relationship got worse, well, let's keep the economic relationship going, as Carlos knows, and made large commitments, and now find it in this area really that Ben described, and when you don't know and don't have much influence over, and events are moving in a way that you don't see where you get traction to a solution. It does seem, from everything that's said, that there's going to be more sanctions. It's also not clear that those sanctions are actually going to change what Russia does. It'll be interesting to see if there are financial sanctions. And actually, even the Eastern European countries are somewhat concerned because they're integrated with the Russian economy. So it's a really complex thing. But I think that, you know, the president said the other day, you know, we're going to increase the pressure. That seems to be the only policy tool that's there. One piece of good news about 3 hours ago actually swore in a new U.S. ambassador to Russia. We've not had an ambassador there during all this crisis since last February. So, and a very accomplished diplomat, and maybe there's some basis for discussion. But Mr. Putin has gone from about 47% popularity to 87%, and that is something that he's not going to want to compromise. So, as Carlos said, it's very tough.
I'm going to say the same thing from a political perspective. I just don't really see a scenario soon where Putin will change course, really, because I think from his perspective, what we've seen so far is that he'll have more strategic leverage as it gets colder. At this point, I think some of his strategic goals, he's not willing to give in on those yet. And he correctly, up until this point, has concluded that there's enough division between the West, within Europe and with the U.S., that he can keep the worst case scenarios from unfolding. That's why, actually, I think what's going on in the NATO summit is so really important, because it actually opens up a slightly different, by the way, much riskier set of conversations about what the military footprint looks like in Eastern Europe, which I think can twist the knife, unfortunately, in ways that make this worse in the short term, not better.
JF, how are the sanctions affecting the ability for Western oil field service providers to operate in Russia?
I can't speak for the Western companies, but I can say a few words on Schlumberger. So, you know, we have been present in that country since before the war, since you know, almost over 70 years, and have been part of the landscape. In fact, you know, in all of the countries around the planet where we've been operated, we recruit from where we work, so we're basically we're part of the landscape with a few people that we rotate in and out. So Russia is no different. It's a very large team. Out of the 130,000 employees in Schlumberger, it's around 10% of the employee population, most of which are Russian. So today we are being hindered in our ability to be efficient in the marketplace, and we're in the process of putting in place all the measures to ensure that we can service our customers within the bounds of the sanctions. As a matter of fact, financially, it's impacting us this quarter. We issued a press release just recently about 3 cents. So there is a material impact brought about by the sanctions. And we're working diligently, you know, to make sure that we can still provide services for our customers there.
I wanted to turn to a couple other places around the world, and Mona on Iraq. How do you see this playing out? Are the lines of Iraq going to look like what they do today a couple of years from now? What does it mean in the south, potentially, where most of the oil production is? But also in the north, what do you think the future of the KRG will be? And how do you think the issue of KRG oil sales will be resolved?
Yeah. So my general view on the border question is that international borders are actually pretty sticky, very hard to kind of get rid of them. And so people, I think, are jumping ahead to a view, which I can totally understand why people might think that you have this ISIS Sunni state in eastern Syria and Iraq. And I think, but I don't think we're there yet, because I think we're at the early stages of this conversation about ISIS and what it means strategically. So a couple of points on it. One, I think lots of people are saying, well, how could you be so surprised about ISIS? I don't think people were surprised about ISIS based on conversations I've had with many people on this. What I think people have been surprised about is ISIS's ability to take and hold territory, which really differentiates it from Al-Qaeda and other terrorist groups. And that's why you see them, they've made the strategic step of recruiting non-militants to run administratively elements of the territory that they control, hence their ability to deal with exporting oil, figuring out the black market, figuring out pricing, all those kinds of dynamics. I would argue that we actually are at the early stage of the impact of the Arab Spring. We're at a point where ISIS really is the first strategic threat to the borders, to the nation state status quo in the region since the Arab Spring. And I think that's part of the reason why you see now this coalition, more or less, of the willing, even though people don't want to admit they're collaborating, because everybody in the region, from Iran, Saudi, you name it, see this as a strategic near-term threat. So what do I think the most likely scenarios for the near term is? That I think ISIS is still going to pose a pretty significant threat, in that it will continue to have the ability to project power beyond the narrow territory that it controls. Not the ability necessarily to take over Baghdad or get into the south, but potentially hit and run kind of strikes. Clearly, we're worried about a terrorism threat in the west, and all of that will continue to be a pretty serious threat. On the KRG question, I think now that the U.S. is involved here, you're going to end up in a situation where that de facto move toward independence, not de jure, means that the KRG is going to come out, I think, pretty much ahead, both short-term and potentially longer-term. And I do envision a scenario, if they pull back a little bit on their goals of independence, could end up with a really win-win scenario for the KRG when all is said and done. And I'll make the last strategic point, because people sometimes ask, what is the lasting strategic impact on the Arab Spring? And because I think we're in the early stages of it, I'm not sure. But the one strategic impact, I think, is that it does mean that the U.S. will have a military footprint in the region for a lot longer than people thought. So 6 months ago, if you had asked people, would the U.S. have a large presence in the region, the answer would have been no, the U.S. is out of Dodge. I think now all of that's turned on its head. It won't look like Iraq operations, obviously, but it will be there for a longer period of time. And I think that will change the dynamics politically in the region as well.
Mona's raised a very interesting question, which was, maybe part of the surprise about ISIS was its capacity, which you've just described. And that raises a question, and which you've said, their ability to incorporate other people to help run things, and be interesting to, if you wanted to elaborate on the degree to which the Ba'athist army, Saddam's army, has elements of that have been incorporated into it. And just to add one other element, it was quite striking when we heard the Secretary of Defense and the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs discuss these things maybe two or three weeks ago at a press conference, where Secretary of Defense said, Hagel said, we've never seen anything like this before. And it was quite different than the President the following week. And it was like quite a big gulf, but
Leaders were pointing out how alarmed are you about this. And obviously there's a modulation in some respects, because I do think a couple of things that they've done. Very clearly there are Ba'athist elements inside ISIS that are planning and understand the strategic landscape, understand militarily how to take and hold territory, who they can do deals with, what the tribal elements are. So they've got a huge advantage politically relative to other players. And through lots of people on the ground in the humanitarian, NGO, and other space, you've been hearing for a while this call of people with expertise to come and support ISIS if you believe in the principles that ISIS is pushing. And I think a lot of the capacity, yes, is the fact that it's really the first time that a terrorist organization like this has really recruited non-militants. It used to be in Al-Qaeda days, you had to go through 6 months of training in Pakistan or Afghanistan, and so you didn't get administratively people with administrative capacity to join up, and that is really, I think, the fundamental difference. And I think this question, though, the reason why I think you see the difference maybe between what the president and what Hegel, the way they're looking at it, and I've not spoken to the president or Hegel about this, but just is that the president has a tendency to think about these things in the long game. And if you think that ISIS is at its apex and it's a straight line here and they're just going to march over territory and take over Iraq, then your hair is on fire. If you think that, in fact, this has created a strategic opportunity for people in the region to think about risk differently, there's both lots of risk and there's potential opportunity, and it's going to be a long conversation for 15, 20 years, potentially, down the road. So that's why I think you have the differing views at this point.
Yeah, if I could jump in on this, because the flip side of what has happened with ISIS in trying to build capacity has almost been kind of the deterioration of the coherence of the Iraqi state.
Yeah.
And under the Maliki regime, the extent to which Iraq was governed under sectarian lines, to the extent to which that even extended itself to the security forces, in which it was a Shia-dominated security force that alienated the Sunnis, and the capacity of the Iraqi security forces after it had been rebuilt two or three times by the United States was, and I think this part was a bit of a shock, of how
Definitely.
Badly that capacity had been deteriorated to protect and hold territory in the other direction.
Yeah.
Okay. It's reflective of a broader issue of what has happened in the Iraqi state and Iraqi governance, of the ability to bring together all aspects of Iraq to try to achieve policy outcomes that are good for Iraq as a state. That brings us back to the energy sector. And here, let me put this as, you know, terrible problems as a from a perspective of opportunity, that when you finally get a unified Iraqi government that comes in, the energy issues that are going to be before them are going to be critical in both the South and the North, and there is potentially an opportunity to put Iraq on a better path, but very real and tough decisions are going to have to be taken early on. And in the South, we've seen a resurgence of production, consistent production of about 3.2 million barrels a day. Gas has been problematic, and Shell has been really trying to help rationalize gas policy. But the next stage of Iraqi oil development can't develop this way. Because in effect, what we've had is rehabilitation of fields. And in the next stage, you're going to have development of new fields. So you're going to go from $2 to $3 billion that have been invested per field in six major superfields to investments of $30 to $40 billion in each of those fields. That's only going to happen if you have a radical change in the way contracts are structured, the way they're financed, the way administrative approvals are given on the ground to expedite movement forward. And a lot of this has been laid out, but the government is going to need to be ready to act on it and move if it wants to get beyond this plateau of 3.5 to 4 million barrels a day. The other piece of it is with Kurdistan region and the north. And Kurdistan region right now, if it does have Kirkuk, if you can get producers back in and if they have security to do that, they have the pipeline capacity now to move 400,000 to 600,000 barrels a day, if not beyond that. 400,000 barrels a day is about $14 to $15 billion worth of revenue a year. That's more or less the break point that the Kurds have calculated as the critical point for independence. They can get to 600,000 barrels a day. The technical ability to do that is certainly there by the end of next year. Whether the security and the political capacity to do that is going to be there is not clear. But that puts them at $20 billion a year in revenue. And so for the choice for the Kurds is going to be, do I take that $20 billion a year and all of my expenses come out of that? or and get zero revenue, which is the case right now from Baghdad? Or is there a new revenue sharing mechanism that is worked out with Baghdad, gives me the benefit of overall state resources, some of the benefits from the south, some of the benefits from the north, and allows me to participate in Iraqi export, an oil export strategy, which is good for Kurdistan region, good for Iraq? That is fundamentally the choice they're going to make. And how this new government answers that is going to be, I think, a critical determinant on whether Kurdistan region is looking at it maintaining that word region, or it's going in another direction. And these things, I think, are going to have to get resolved and put on the table in the next 6 months if there is going to be a rational course of development and how energy is going to play into that in Iraq's political future.
Although, Carlos, don't you think that the near-death experience at the hands of ISIS was probably a little bit of a wake-up call, my guess is, for the KRG? Up until this point, thinking that they, you know, they had pretty much everything under control.
I think you're absolutely right, and I think it just changed in the last 10 days. Because previously, the perspective when the Iraq security forces were not able to defend Kirkuk, and the Peshmerga came in, then the equation was even more acute, right? Because I get zero revenue from Baghdad, I get zero security
benefit. And I still
benefit.
Have to, right.
And so now there's been a bit of a reassessment. Maybe the Peshmerga is not exactly everything. What I thought, which actually opens up an opportunity for compromise, which even 10 days ago was
not possible. It was not
possible.
I agree with that, yeah.
There's a lot of really excellent questions here, so I appreciate everyone's making my job easier. I want to get through as many of them as we can. There's one or two about cost. I want to make sure we touch on that, given that we have a service company here. You know, at CERAWeek this year, John Watson, I think, said the Chevron CEO, 100 is the new 20. I don't know, Dan, if you have thoughts. The IOCs are clearly concerned about rising CapEx. What impact do you see the newly announced capital discipline measures having on increased supply? And JF, what do you think the service sector can do to respond to those challenges and how much room there is for some cost deflation in the upstream?
Right. Well, when I was writing the quest, I went back to that period 2003, 2004, and what was being said by the investment analysts was rather similar to what's being said today. Capital discipline, we don't want to see people spending money, that they should focus on just being more efficient in use of capital. And then, of course, demand took off, and it turned out the industry had underinvested. Partly under the pressure of the institutional investors. But it does feel, you know, listening to the discussion, what's the next crisis, where's the next spare capacity going to come from, you know, how much risk there is. But it does seem that a decade period has come to an end for the industry, which was this expansion. Let's catch up. We've got to invest. And obviously, as everybody knows, costs went up enormously. We have these cost indices. And it just did because there were not enough petroleum engineers, not enough this, not enough of that. And I think it does seem that the industry has reached a point now in which the focus is what Ben described, which is on kind of rationalizations of portfolio. What should the companies focus on? And how do you get a handle on costs? What do you do so that you're not in this constantly escalating cost environment? And it's like it's like moving from one era to another era.
So on the service side, you know, I'll be perfectly blunt here. You know, our industry is not the most efficient industry. It's certainly not an airline industry. It's certainly not like the automotive industry. You know, it's one layer down. And our thesis is that in order to be able to go forward and really enable, you know, the journey over the next 30, 40, 50 years in an economically viable manner, we have to get much more efficient. And by that I mean, in an environment where our customers are drilling wells in the deep waters of the Gulf of Mexico or Brazil or West Africa, the tools that they use, the drill ship, can be $1 million to $1.5 million a day cost, right, per day. And inefficiencies in our business, you know, lead to downtime. And that downtime is paid by our customers, right? They bear the brunt of that. And that has to change, right? We can't continue to spend money. You know, we had a discussion a little bit earlier on free cash flow, right? That's not sustainable. So what we're doing is we're trying to transform the service sector to become much, much more efficient, to go from the level where it operates today, improve its efficiency on the order of tenfold in how it does things, and get similar in the manner of operation that the automobile industry has achieved over the last decades. We believe that's doable. If you look at assets, this is all about business. The assets in our company, in Schlumberger, do something a lot less than 10% of the time during a month. In fact, a lot of times it can be, on the order of, let's call it a couple days a month, right? The rest of the time they sit idle, right? The airline industry certainly wouldn't be here today, if it operated that way. And all of the costs for having that capital idle really get translated and borne by our customers. So we have, a lot of focus on trying to improve our efficiencies with respect to capital. And that means just changing the way we do business. And, some customers want to embark in that journey. Some are a little bit more reluctant, a little bit more historical in the way they do things. And we believe that it's this ability to integrate an operation and have much more control on an operation, which is going to create an environment that's sustainable in the long term, whether it's in the deep waters or the unconventional plays of this world, whether it's in the Arctic or just right here in the middle of the U.S. of A. Yeah.
You'll not be surprised to learn many people in this room would like to know if the U.S. is going to export its oil. So, Carlos, you're just out of the administration. You can say whatever you want now. If you want to tell us if you think we should change the oil export policy or if you think that will happen, maybe, Moan, if you can put your political hat on for a second and tell us how you think this will play out. And then maybe, Dan, you can say a word about the study IHS did recently.
Good.
I'm going to defer to her to go first. She's been the political consultant on these issues. I'm probably so brainwashed by working in the U.S. government, I don't know if I can give you a rational answer.
Well, this is because if you were based on logic, we would be exporting oil and gas. So, I mean, my general view has been for a while that there are lots of great economic and national security arguments for exporting oil. And of course, this is a hyper-political issue in the United States. But I actually think it actually runs deeper than that. It's really at the core of American psychology that the average person in the United States, we have just not gotten ourselves around to the notion that the U.S. is a major hydrocarbons producer. Right? We are the victim of energy markets. We are not a participant in them. And because of that, we all understand the disconnect between your export question and what the price is at the pump, but that needs to be explained to people because it is a rational conclusion that, well, why would you want to export oil and I'm having to pay more at the pump? It's hard to argue, and we all know the beauty. I used to work for Rahm Emanuel. We all know the beauty of a 30-second ad, really easy ad to produce, very difficult ad to produce, to explain that no, those two things don't really have anything to do with each other because one is a global market. That's not going to work. So I actually think I think the net effect of this is nibbling around the edges, which we've already started to see for the next couple of years, but I actually think eventually, something will happen in the world geopolitically where we otherwise would have thought about releasing the energy from the SPRO. And that will trigger a huge conversation about oil exports. And if that doesn't happen anytime soon, and there are a lot of candidates, by the way, for what that could be, if that doesn't happen, I think in the back end of TTIP and TPP, assuming they're successful, I think this question...
European
Trade Agreement and the Asia Free Trade Agreement. On the back end of that, I could see a move to try to rationalize our treatment of natural gas, which once you have a free trade agreement, you don't need approvals to export, try to rationalize the oil and gas treatment in a free trade context. And that's really the political path that I see to really make a huge lift. Up until that point, I think you'll see lots of ideas being bandied about. And by the way, that's all hugely important thought leadership that needs to happen, like what the center is doing, because that is the bedrock upon which a consensus can get built, and then people are waiting for the political opportunity to move things forward. So,
if I can add, the center is doing a very important study in oil exports. We at IHS did one which looked at the economic impact, and the economic impact of eliminating this ban in terms of what it would mean for additional activity in the United States is a very significant economic benefit to the country. And we're doing a part two now to look at what it means for states, including states that don't produce oil, but because of the long supply chains. And so I kind of think it's a combination of that, and if we got into a period where we started to see the discount between world prices and U.S. prices really gap growing again, we saw basically the drilling going down, activity slowing down, and then I think you would get more more political support on Capitol Hill for it. Yeah. But I'll just say one other thing. It's, you know, so you ask the question, why do we have a ban on this? Mm-hmm. By the way, we export 4 million barrels a day of oil, but it's in the form of product. It's gasoline and diesel. So why crude oil? It was put in the 1970s, number one, because we had a price control system. And if you had a price control system, you couldn't allow exports because it would undermine it. And number two, it was put in to prevent the export of Alaskan oil to Japan in 1979-1980. Well, price controls were abolished in 1981. President Clinton removed the ban on exporting Alaskan oil. That's the one form of crude that can be exported. Meanwhile, we still have this antique, this archaic policy in place, which really does go in the face of what the U.S. has been saying to countries around the world for decades now, free markets and energy.
When do you think it's going to be possible to have a sensible political discussion on this issue? Can it happen prior to the next presidential elections, or is it an issue that is inevitably going to have to wait until the next presidential or after presidential election?
I mean, my personal view has been is that energy will be the dominant discussion in the 2016 election in the big policy realm, because it is so consequential. It's one of the few places where you see divergence about what the strategies might be. Now, that's not to say, I think one of the challenges we have is that as you tinker on the margins, you actually relieve pressure. So you are allowing some exports to get out, and that removes the pressure of a shut-in scenario, which is the pressure you need to get the bigger a bigger ban lifted. So I think there's a little bit of a trick there. But I actually think we're at the early stages. So the work that everybody is doing, my observation of big policy changes in the United States is you need a lot of intellectual work done to make it so that there's a broader understanding across the entire elite landscape before you take the next step, which is engaging the public. So I'd say we actually have a lot more work to do as an elite community to understand what the pro and con arguments are, understand what some of the politics are, before we're ready to take the next step, I think. So I'm not sure anybody's ready for it as much as everybody in this room, I guess, is.
I think you can say definitively that we will have a decision on this after the November election. I just won't say which November election.
There's
I'm going to use that line.
A good pitch for the forthcoming center study on this. Just one last question, and then we'll wrap up, because there are a couple of questions here that I think are pretty important. Carlos, maybe I'll ask you to speak to them about what the role of private extraction companies is in developing markets. You spent a lot of time at the State Department thinking about energy access and energy poverty. We've talked about the challenges of development of the resource, but how do we make sure those resources benefit people without energy? And then how do we think about the challenges of trying to power that rapidly emerging part of the world's population that needs access to energy resources in a way that, you know, provides us some hope of dealing with climate change before it's too late?
I think this is one of the great and huge geopolitical questions in front of us. It's clearly an energy issue. It's clearly linked to economic growth, but it's also a political issue, because to what extent can we still imagine the continued stability in parts of the world if there is a fundamental dichotomy between those who have access to energy resources and those who don't? So think about it first from a perspective of hydrocarbons. Nigeria has, on paper, 40% energy access or electricity access. It's probably less than that in the countryside. It's probably in the teens. Angola, well, less than that. Places like Tanzania and Mozambique, 11, 12, 13% energy access. To what extent do you think eventually those countries can continue to develop those hydrocarbon resources in an environment of greater political openness and with the development of civil society that doesn't in the end result in greater economic benefit to the country and access to their own population? And we have to recognize that. And so the issues of energy transparency, how those resources are managed, how resources go back to the budget, and how eventually those resources translate in bringing energy access to the population, I think is one of the critical issues that we have to address in hydrocarbons-rich countries that don't have access for their own population and is pressing and paramount. There are issues related to energy access that are large power infrastructure investment questions. And here the tensions become really tough because it was enlightening to me having a conversation with some of the private equity firms. And so we were talking about investments in power and renewable energy, and they said, I know we're close over time, but I'll just relay this really quick. All right, so this guy tells me, if I make a power investment in Texas, I can find out what the hour-by-hour generation is. I have access online to revenue flows into the company. If I have a problem, I call somebody up and I resolve it in half an hour. So managing a 300 megawatt investment takes me half an hour a week. Can you imagine how much time it takes me to manage the same investment in Nigeria? Why should I do it? And so until we change that equation, it's going to be really hard to get the kind of capital flows that we need into these areas. And I haven't even touched on the issue of off-grid investment, and we don't have time to do it. But I would just say this. A lot of people have estimated that sort of the optimal size for off-grid distributed investments in developing countries might be like 10 kilowatts. 10 kilowatts. So you have to repeat these things hundreds and hundreds of thousands of times over and over again. And until you develop the mechanisms to be able to replicate them, handle the financing, and give confidence in the technology and the ability to do it, it's going to be really hard to resolve that problem. And I think that we are just at the beginning points of being able to address these issues. And I'm sorry to take time at the very end, but it is so important. And it's one of the reasons why initiatives like the Sustainable Energy for All initiative by the World Bank and the UN are so important right now, because they are just such tough and fundamental issues to resolve, but they're so critical to economic development and growth and global political stability.
Well, in fact, it's so important that I think on September 24th, you'll be hosting a discussion about these very issues with Nobel laureate Dr. Pachauri and a few other panelists as well. So we're going to spend a lot more time talking about these during the time of your fellowship here. There were several questions about China, which we also did not get to, but that is also an issue we'll be addressing on September 11th in the evening at the Columbia Club in Midtown, a discussion with a great lineup of speakers, many from Beijing as well as from here, including David Sandelow, who's about to finish a new research project on energy in China, and Zhang Gaobao, the former vice chairman of the NDRC, director of the National Energy Administration in China, as well as others. And you heard about lots of the research reports we'll have coming out over the next several months on Mexican energy reform, on U.S. LNG export policy, crude oil export policy, and many other things. So hopefully all of you can join for all of those upcoming discussions and events to release our new research products. If you're unable to join, you can always follow us on Twitter, watch our events either live stream or taped on our website, or starting today, download them as podcasts. And this will be the first event that now these will be on our website and on iTunes, downloadable as podcasts that people can listen to the center's events. So on behalf of I should say that as soon as we wrap up, just behind the stage here, there's a reception for about an hour, and all of you are welcome to join. So on behalf of everyone at the Center on Global Energy Policy, I want to thank you all for coming. Please join me in thanking our guests for a really fascinating and sweeping discussion of today's energy landscape.